today's session we're doing a run through of how to put a plan in the portal and generate a plan in the portal. So we're going to basically do this plan. It was just a two-lot subdivision, and it's a boundary realignment, and we're creating a bit of a road widening. That's going to be our end product after today, which is all drawn in the portal. We will start by going back to our dashboard. So hopefully everyone's familiar with the dashboard. You would have used that just to create all your plans in CAD and lodge them through here. So a lot of your stuff is in design, you create your plan. If you've just done a CAD one, then you just attach your PDF and lodge it straight through. When we do a portal one, we'll actually progress through the relevant tabs of your dashboard. So a quick overview of the dashboard is that we've got, when you log in, you'll have your login name up there. You will view all the plans that you are working on or that you've created. You can go to your organizational plans. That will just give you a much bigger list. It's going to give you what's assigned to your organization. And then you can reassign jobs with the little man to yourself if you want to work on a job that someone else has done or created within your organization. For today's purpose, we're going to our own plans, and we're going to create a plan from scratch. Once we've created the plan in our design and fully drawn our plan and design, we'll progress it through the rest of the dashboard. I'll go through that in more detail as we go. So after we've done it, we'll show you how to get it through to ready for QA. Ready for certification is when your surveyor will sign the plan once he's satisfied with it. So depending on the structure of your company, you don't have to go to QA. If you don't have a QA officer, if the draftee does it, the surveyor just checks it. You can move it straight from design, assign it to the certifying surveyor, who can then do the checks, put his signature on the plan, move it to ready for lodgement, and then it can be lodged. So the QA generally is there for the bigger firms who have QA officers. So you've got draftees, QAs, and then the surveyor will sign it once it's passed through any of that QA. You can use it however you like in your company. If you've drafted it and it's waiting for clearances, you can leave it in ready for QA and then sign it when you've got your clearances if you need to. It just depends how you want to use the workflow and the dashboard. I will cover that in more detail in different webinars to come, just to get used to that. That's a following webinar for another day. Today we're going to just go through how to create a portal plan from beginning to end. Before I start, has everyone had a play in the portal, or is this new to lots of people?
Well, that's new to me.
Yep.
The majority of it will be new to me, Harry. Just for uploading and lodging the plan.
Yeah.
Nothing else.
Cool. Oh well, that's good. So an intuitive little system. So once you get used to it, it goes through quite well. So hopefully, we'll give you a bit of insight where it is, so then you can be comfortable to go away and play in the portal. The best thing with the portal is once you've done it, your jobs, you can come back and revisit them, and we suggest, especially after today, just go back and try one in the portal when you can, just to get familiar with it. You can delete your job at the end of the day, so you can create a dummy job and leave it in there and come back to it whenever you like, when you've got a spare 10 minutes or so just to have a tinker and a play, and then if you don't want it at the end of the day, you can just remove it out of your portal. But it's a great place to do test jobs. So to start off, we'll go to create plan. This is very familiar to all of you guys. This is very similar to what you do for a CAD plan. There's a few differences which I'll go through. So you just enter your surveyor. We're going to do a freehold subdivision, DP. I'm just going to put in a random DP number. We're creating two lots on our plan. Customer reference number. heading, so I'm going to do 100. Once we've basically got our plan type and number, we can now actually change it to being, we go to our little actions menu or hamburger button, we call it, just a hamburger thing, and we're going to change the status to be created the PDF in the portal. At the moment, in our information tabs, it's telling us the type of plan, so we've now got a freehold DP with a plan number. We can say we're going to create this plan instead of a CAD software, we're going to actually create it in the portal. When we click on that, it then gives us a couple more tabs in here. It's going to give us portal and it'll give us a little bit more information we've got to enter for our plan details in our information screen. So now in our formula tenure table, it's going to ask us about the new lots and how they relate to our parent lots, because this will automatically build our formula tenure table on our plan. So I'll just fill in this area quickly. So this is the same as what we had before, the only difference is this section here. So our former tenure was a freehold plan, oh, and a diagram. Okay, plan, 11198, well, and parent lot, 24, and we're going to get plus, and this was a diagram, 48212. So this section now is telling us our new lots. The first part of this is very rarely used, but it has to be there in case it is. So if our former tenure, this lot 24, has been fully superseded by a road or road widening with no lot number, then we'd hit yes, and it's not going to ask you to put your correlating lots in there, because in your former tenure table, it will just say lot 24 is now road widening. 99.9% of the time it's going to be no, so you've got to enter which lots are coming out or comprising the former lot 24. So as this is a boundary realignment, both lots are going to be, there's a bit coming in and out of lot 24, so it's going to be lots 100 to 101, and similar for the other lot. Have we got any questions on that so far? Yeah, I can hear someone in the background there.
Okay, guys. So it's Dave Bustle. I got online a bit late. I couldn't get the paperwork.
Oh, cool. You're coming through quite fine there, Dave. Welcome. Very good. So we've got everyone on speaker. So, yeah, so once we've got through that bit, we will verify that. It will check that your former tenures do exist and that they are relevant things. We can okay that. It's now built our former tenure table, pulled in our title reference details and our local government and locality, straight off our certificates of title, and we've got our new lots which are relating to those. So that's basically going to build our former tenure table in our diagram, and I mean our deposit plan. The localities and local government are being pre-populated straight from your certificates of title. Your survey details, this one's not an SSA, so we're just going to hit no, and it's a conventional survey. This is the new section for plans within the portal. Because we are now bringing our CSD straight into our SCDB layer, we've got to select our projected coordinate system that our files are going to come into. So, and here you've got all your relevant projections that are around. So we've got Christmas Island, we've got Exmouth, we're going right up to, we can even get geodetic datum. This plan is in MGO Zone 50, so we would check that. The CSD can come in as a plane coordinate file, so you would check your projection that you're going to import that plane coordinate file into our SCDB, so it will then relate to that coordinate system. Or if your CSD or your DGN is in projected coordinates, you have to have the the nominated projection. So if you've got a PCG 94 CSD file, you can't bring it, you can't select an NGO that's zone 50. It won't do a transformation. It'll only bring it in at the specified projection. If that makes sense to everyone. Yep. So field book. Enter your field book number, same as your planning. I've got nice fictitious numbers. The road section, so this is new to a portal plan. So if we are generating or creating a road, then we would need to fill in this section. These two basically will create an order for dealings condition on our plan. So if we are including a private right of way or if there's a closed road action, then it will put in an order for dealings condition if we hit yes on your plans. So it's important to note your closed road action is only for the whole of a closed road. At the moment we don't have capability for inset lots as yet, so we can't do a partial road closure. We can only do a fully extent of a road polygon that's been closed and included. The next one is a new road or road widening or extension being created on the plan. This one we are creating a road widening, so we're going to hit yes. It's also going to ask you to actually specify which road your road widening is being included into. So for this plan, we're on the corner of Hume Road and Cassidy Road. So it will list all the roads within the locality of Thornley. So you can just start typing and it will filter down to whatever roads there are, because that's a pre-existing road. If you are creating a new road as part of your subdivision, it's very important to note that we have to have your road names lodged with our Geonoma, our road name database. Otherwise, it won't let you actually create your road name on your plan until it's actually in our road name database at LandGoat, because it will have to be on our road name list to populate down. So if you've got a proposed road name, you can't lodge your plan with without that road name approval being registered with LandGoat in our geographic names area. This last one is very rare as well. So this is for if they've got a main highway, which they're doing a big road name opening, and the ministers there cut the ribbon and declare it open as Bustle Highway or something, and they want to suppress the road name until the big ribbon cutting ceremony, then you can have your road name approval exemption, and you can just put road one on your plan, and then they will gazette the road name after the road that has been dedicated on your survey. Very rarely happens, but it does happen, so there is capability for that if it needs to be done. The last little one is if there's any Crown land being included or any Crown instructions, then you can hit yes, and they'll ask you to attach any of that information at lodgement. We can save all that. So yeah, the only difference with this really is our former tenure, our projections coordinate system, and roads that come with your design. So once we've saved that and validated that, I'll get a couple of errors because the plan number is a fictitious one, and the field book possibly may give us an error. But for demonstration purposes, I can just go through this. So it will validate your plan number that it has been assigned to the survey firm, and that plan number does exist, and it is allocated to that survey company that is lodging or creating this plan. The analysis tab will come up and look at your former tenure, and if there's anything within the lodge layer that is related to that former tenure, it will come up and ask you to, it'll display it on a separate screen and ask you if it's being modified, surrendered, or superseded. And it'll ask you an action to happen on that existing former tenure. It's fairly self-explanatory through that tab. This one, there is no former tenure, no former interest over those lots. So it gave us, there's no interest. It's now got an interest tab. Oh, this example doesn't have one. It will actually, this is one of the beauties with the portal, it will go go to your certificates of title and it will display any relevant land interest that is pertinent to those former tenures. And they will be listed here on your plan, and you will have certain actions to do to relate to those interests. So it will say if there's an existing drainage easement, they will say if there's a 167 drainage easement over lot 24, are you going to bring it forward over your new lots, and which lots are coming forward? Are they going to be partially surrendered or is it going to be fully surrendered? And you'd have to state what action is going to happen to that interest, and it will be displayed on a former interest table. Later on, I'll switch to a plan that does have former interest, just to show you how it interacts and how it looks on the plan. It does show whole of lot interest, will now also be shown on your deposit plan. So if there's a notification on your parent lot, that will now carry forward onto your new survey. It will be over the whole of your new lots, which is great for planning because they always say, oh, you haven't shown your notification on your new survey, you should create it again, even if it's on your parent title, because previously on CAD plans, we don't show whole of lot interests coming forward. Portal plans, we now do, so we validate all these interests against your digital certificate of title. So there's lots of checks and balances that happens with a portal plan as you go and as you're creating it. New interests we can create, so we can create our interests on our plan, so it will filter your interests relevant to the purpose of your survey. So we're doing a freehold subdivision, we're not going to be able to create strata interests on a freehold plan or crown interests on a freehold plan if they're not applicable to this plan type. So we have a list of every type of notification that we'll filter down. For today's purpose, we're just going to do a 136C drainage easement, and we'll also do a 150 restriction of access. So if I just start typing in 136C, it's going to start listing all the 136C type of easements. You can keep typing through or you can just pick from the list. We're going to do a drainage easement. So it will pre-fill a lot of your fields just to eliminate. We pre-fill as much as we can to eliminate just typos happening on your plan. There is obviously fields that need to be done, but we will pre-populate as much as we can just to reduce the typo error that can happen on some surveys. So this one has to be created on this plan because it's 136C new interest. The subject is a label for our interest, so we'll label this one as A. Subject A, our burden lot is going to be lots 100, obviously both actually, 101, because the interest is going to go along the back of both lots as a drain to the city of Gosnells. So we can choose, so your benefits can be lots on the plan or outside the plan, or your named beneficiaries. So this is going to be the local government, and if you type in Gosnells, then city of Gosnells will come up on. We can save that, and that's our first interest we're creating on our plan. We'll add also a 150 restriction of access covenant on our plan. This is going to be against lot 100 on the corner, so they just want to, I'm pretending a planning condition is just restricting access to the main road for the corner lot, and they just want access only from the side road, so we're going to call it B. And it's going to burn lot 100. Again, to the city of Gosnells. And we'll put restriction access to Hume Road, to and from. So those are our two interests we will create on our plan. So that's basically all of our detail, our heading detail and our interest detail for our plan. Now comes the fun bit, we jump into our design screen. So our design screen now, as of last week, has a nice black background to it. So when we bring in our survey data, we can bring it in and we can see it's been placed over our existing thing and we can get all our battle information from there. I'll just bring in the CSD for now. So for importing our survey data, we've got three methods to bring it in. We can bring it in as a CSD file, we can bring it in as a DWG file or an ASCII point file. The ASCII point file obviously is your least amount of data, so it's going to create a lot of work in the portal because you've got to build everything from scratch. You just have your points and then you've got to create your lines, create your polygons, create your lots, attribute everything. And it is possible, it's a fair amount of work to do. Your DWG can come in and that's got your lines and points and polygons already there. They're not necessarily attributed and associated with the lots. There is specifications we can email you for the different layers and the attributes you need for a DWG file. Or you can bring in your CSD file, which is at the moment our recommended method for doing it. This brings in the richest amount of data. You'll have all your lots and your line types attributed already straight from your CSD file. It's kind of changing work practice. I know a lot of surveyors do their CSD right at the end of their job as a mathematical check and just your misclose check. As your plan is now generated in the portal, we recommend you do your CSD up the front when you're ready to do your plan to make sure your mathematics are correct, because your plan basically is generated from that CSD file. So that is your check. It's just changing the stage and when you do it. So you have your mathematical check up front, and then we'll just import that CSD. It'll display it on your portal and we put up the graphics ready for basically being lodged as your file. So your CSD and your portal plan will always be the same source of truth. I'll quickly go and find my CSD. So I saved it on my desktop. I can upload that. I'll import the CSD file. So a lodge layer basically is just a graphical layer in the background just to show where we are. This icon here toggles it on and off to show our cadastre layer behind our graphics. This is our CSD file that's come into the portal. You can see with the black background, we've basically got it color-coded similar to the CSD spec. So rows are now red line work, lot boundaries are green, interest in the portal are yellow, and we've also got the CSD automatically hides your external angles for your lots. Any hidden features will be a magenta color. I'll just change the scale so it's a bit more readable. It comes in automatically at scale 1 to 750. This plan would probably only want is about 1 to 300. So I'll just change the scale so it's a bit more presentable. So, and you'll see it actually change the scale of the font on your screen. So all your font types and sets and sizes are preset, and these are all a standardized font type and style now, so we can't actually change any of that within the portal. So interest will be 1/8 upright, lot boundaries are a 2/5 italic, lot numbers are 3/5 italic, areas are all preset font types and styles, depending on the attributes of the lines they're associated with. But that's basically our existing graphic. The original lot boundaries basically ran through that way, so this is just doing a realignment of that boundary and also creating a road widening here. So you rode there and Cassidy rode along this way. Before we get too involved, I'll quickly just go through our icons and our functions of the different features here. So we've done our import survey data with our CSD import. This button, for some reason, isn't bringing in our cadastral layer, but this is what we would click on to show and hide our slip layer behind our CSD. When you're doing drafting, generally we recommend turning that off, because then it's not trying to refresh a whole lot of background information that's not necessary while you're doing your drafting. You can turn it on to get all your battle information and plot your battles. The next feature here is our construct feature tool. This one has options for constructing all different features that we want. So it'll come up with points, lines, polylines, which we use for restriction of access. We can construct polygons, angles, control points. We can create offset marks, corner offset marks, total lot boundary distances, and we can dissect lines, and we can create lots. We'll go into this tool set in a lot more detail later on. All of the tools will have instructions for each one, and they're relevant to whatever feature you select. So if you go to lines, it's got a different set of instructions, and if it's got a different type of line, it'll also have different instructions depending on what line type or feature you select. So there should be instructions for any of your construction tools that you need. They're fairly easy to follow as well. The next button is for our annotation tools. So this is where we can create annotations, so we can do depth limits, a battle lots, a battle roads, we can put improvement stuff, we can town site, state forest. All of these are set with preset font and type styles for each of the annotations. This one is to rotate annotations, so we can select a feature. It gives us a red circle and a box of a grab point, so that we can then drag and it will rotate along the direction of the central line wherever we want. So we can move and rotate text with this annotation rotation tool. Escape out. I'll put that back for now. The other option is we can also align annotations to a feature. So we can select a bit of text. We hit control, we can do multiple selections. We can select the line and that text. So any selection will come up with a blue border, and then that will just align that text to that line. It's very handy for roads. When you're doing road labeling, you can just create your road name and just align it to the road boundary line, and it'll put it on the correct bearing for your road. Before I go into the buttons too much, I should go over navigation buttons. There are a few navigation buttons around. So to zoom in and out, you just use the wheel on your mouse. We've tried to line this up to most CAD stuff. So to select, you just click on it to select. You can hit control to do multiple selections or add or subtract from a selection. If you don't have control, it will just deselect everything and select whatever you've clicked on. So multiple ones, you have to hold control to add or subtract from your selection. To zoom, I've done the mouse wheel. You can use the zoom area button, or this one will just zoom to your plan extent. To pan, you have to hold the Alt key down and your icon will change to a little arrow, and that will pan your graphics around the screen. Shift will do a window zoom, and most often I just use the mouse wheel. Alt is the pan, or you can use the arrow key on the keyboard for a finer pan detail, just with the Alt key, the arrow keys on your keyboard. So that's just to move around your graphics. There is, I'll come back to that, we'll go over these ones just to navigate through, and then we'll come back and finish those. There is different selection modes. So this one here, as you zoom to your plan extent, that's your window zoom. So that will always do a window zoom. You have to escape to get out of that one. You can pick a scale just for your display window, and that will change your plan to that. The lock panning I'll cover later, that is when we go to our attributes. It will actually zoom to the selected attribute that you pick out of your attribute list. We generally have it locked because otherwise when we're doing a lot of work in our attributes, your graphics are constantly jumping all over the place because it's zooming to that selected attribute. These now are selection features. So those are just basically navigation and zooming features. These ones are to do with our selections. So that's a select all, and that'll select everything in your plan. Escape to deselect, or there is a clear selection feature here. To select, at the moment I'm on a point selector, so it will sort of show a little circle with a little crosshair in the middle, and that to select. We can change to a rectangle selection tool, so that will select everything that intersects the rectangle that we have. Or if you do your rectangle right to left, then it'll only select features within that rectangle. So it's only selected those two because they were wholly within the rectangle. We go left to right, then it selects everything that intersects the rectangle. It's very handy if you're doing bulk selections of an area. If you want to do hide a whole lot of features because you want to do an enlargement, say, of this area, we can just select all of that. Not that we would, but yeah, because you can also filter your selection features. So you just put it on all angles, draw your rectangle over there, and it'll pick up just all those angles all in one hit. So you can do rectangle selections, point selections, which I generally default to for more accurate stuff. There's circle, ellipse, lasso, free, and line selections is just select whatever intersects that line at the time. So if you draw a line across, it's going to select that line, the polygon, the two polygons, and there's an even polygon, a lock polygon, and that line as part of that selection. Most of the time I live between point and rectangle selections. Point's my default. You can also filter on what features are going to be as part of your selection. So if we just choose angle annotations and go back to the rectangle, if I draw a rectangle over there, all it will select now is the angles feature. So it's a bit like a layers feature. We don't have layers in the portal as yet. So we can filter by feature type. So that is only going to now pick up all angles. I can't select a line if I want to. It will only pick up basically angles. That doesn't automatically turn off, so if you want to choose something after angles, you've got to switch back to all features, and then you can choose other features that you wish. Great to get out. That's your clear select features. This is our scary delete button. It is important to note we don't have an undo feature in here, so it's a bit like CSV Editor. We have built this little tool, which is our snapshot tool. So it will create a snapshot of your workspace, so you can switch between different snapshots. So it's a bit like a system restore point. It will create one every time you log in. So you've got one, and then you can create a snapshot at any stage you like just by hitting the little camera, and then you'll have an additional snapshot. So you can take as many as you like for your session. It is important to note these are only basically relevant for the work session that you're in. So if you go back to your dashboard, it will actually clear this cache. These snapshots are held within your working memory of your computer. Once you go out to your dashboard, or you go out of the design screen fully, then it's going to actually clear that memory cache, and it will start again next time you go back into your design. So it's a very handy feature, but it doesn't keep those forever. Otherwise, yeah, we'd have to have rooms full of servers just to hold lots of memory. So it's only there for your relevant design mode that you're in at the time. But saying that, it's very handy because if you do delete something by mistake, then you can associated with that line. And so, yeah, delete's a bit of a scary thing to hit, especially if it's part of your CSV data, because it will remove all of that information and you'd have to rebuild that from scratch. It is possible to rebuild, it's just a bit more work. So I generally recommend hitting a snapshot before you hit your delete, if you need to delete features. Saying that, a delete, we have different options within our delete, so we can delete everything on the plan, we can delete just the enlargements, we can get rid of the lots, we can unlink the lots. So at the moment we've got a lot polygon, and then we've also got a lot feature, which is our lot number, that is associated with the polygon. So we can unlink that lot 100 to that polygon, and we can assign that to a different lot number on our interest if they want to change lot numbers or something down the track. And we can unlink all our interests. At the moment, our interest polygons are unlinked, and also our roads, and our road polygon is unlinked, but we will link them to the different features I'll show you later on. So these can unlink all of those or delete any of those features we want to within that. The next little button is our view. At the moment, it's only a main plan. If we draw enlargements, then we will get a different sheet for our enlargement views, and this is to toggle just between the different views. This feature is to create our enlargements. So it's relatively simple to create an enlargement on the plan. We'll do a couple later on, so I'll go through that in more detail. Your enlargements will be created on a separate sheet, and they will correlate to the plan. So the beauty with this is any changes you make to your plan graphics will automatically change on your enlargement plan as well. We did this specifically because there was a lot of analysis over 5 years worth of errors in plan lodgements, and the majority of the errors were coming up from enlargements where a plan distance or enlargement thing has been tweaked or changed and one's been forgotten to be done, and a lot of errors were coming up in enlargements. So the beauty of the portal is any change you make to your plan graphic will automatically change on your enlargement as well. They basically, it does a snapshot of your plan, but it keeps that association with your plan on your enlargement sheet, so they will never differ as to what information they show. Hence, we'll discuss it later, but yeah, the scale factor with enlargements is we can't have a not to scale enlargement because we need to keep the association of that feature to the main plan, to your enlargement graphic. We'll cover that when we draw enlargements. The next one is our display mode. We've got a black background at the moment. We can switch between a white background if people prefer to draft in the white background. This just shows our plan graphics. There is little green selection nodes for our different features on our plan. So to move that thing, we'd have to click on that green selection point, and that will allow us to select and move our distances or angles or any of those features that we need. There's a print preview, which is just a quick print preview view of your plan graphics. Before when we had this, you had to actually generate your PDF to have a look at what the final product would look like. This one is just a quick button to show you a general overview of how your plan is going to look on your final PDF. So you can just do it. Sometimes it's good to do a glance at print preview just so things jump out when you're not in the design screen and there's a bit more noise on your screen. I'll go back to our black background because it defaults to that as we go. I like the black background because it, if we've got a wrong line attribute, it'll stick out like a sore thumb. So if we've got a road boundary and we haven't actually labelled it as a road boundary, you're going to have a green boundary sitting on your road, and it's going to be very obvious that you haven't changed the attribute of that line type. The last feature on here, the resolution. In the plan, we've got it as vector graphics. I'll show you that. if you are out in the bush or the country, and I've had it with one surveyor already, they log in using the mobile as a hotspot. You can change it to low resolution graphics, which doesn't chew through so much data. It obviously doesn't look as pretty, but it certainly will operate a lot smoother and faster, especially if you're out in a rural job and you don't have a great internet connection. Then that's a very handy feature if you have to log in and do something on the portal. It will default to high graphics, and you'll have very crisp, clean lines and feature types. The Cavada snapshot tool, these last buttons, so we can export our CSV data or our survey data out of the portal. So if we make any amendments or changes to our CSV, we can export the CSV file out of the portal and save that on our workspace for that job, just so you have a record in the office. When you go to lodge a portal plan, it will automatically generate the CSV out of the portal and attach that on your lodgement, so you don't need to lodge a CSV file, because it will be automatically extracted out of the portal. Your settings button. Sorry?
Can you only export it as a CSV file?
At the moment, yes. We will be building capability to export it as a DWG or an ASCII file. Unfortunately, that's still under development, the DWG. If you try to do it, it's just going to say it's not implemented as yet. But we will be building implementation to export it as a DWG file. So, yeah, currently at the moment it's only a CSV format, but yeah, there is we're currently working on programming to get a DWG extract out of the portal and an ASCII file. The ASCII one's tricky. I don't know. I'd see people using a DWG. I don't know about the ASCII file, but we'll build that capability in as well. The settings button we've been touch. So this is going to be to generate our plan at the end. So if I do it now, you can put a watermark across your plan. So and we can print that. So that's going to nominate our paper size and our scale. If we print, it will actually open a pop-up window and it will generate the plan for you. So you can generate your plan at any stage you like. So you can generate your plan up front for clearance purposes or wherever else, and print that off and submit that whatever you like, or show your client before you want to lodge. This has all our information we entered on our initial screen. There's our former tenure table. It's built for us. And our new interest table is all within our plan. And then we've got a separate sheet for our graphics. We'll obviously pretty up our graphics so that we don't have, we'll show our battles, and we'll fix up all the angles so they're not intersecting lines and overlapping. And we've got additional angles. We can hide different angles we don't need. But that's just a print preview of our plan at the moment. We'll close that pop-up window. It is important to note in Google Chrome, a lot of the time there is default pop-up blocker. You will need to enable pop-ups from Landgate, because that's how our PDF comes up as a separate window. So the first time you go in, if you hit your PDF, it may not come up and you'll have a little cross up here, and you're just going to allow pop-ups within your navigational plane of your browser. The validate button is, this is going to run all our business rules. So if we click on this, it runs up to about 280 different business rules on every line, angle, feature, and it'll give you a whole gamut of errors to begin with, because we haven't identified any of our points, and we get all these errors coming up. They are pretty easy to go through, but it will do lots of mathematical checks, and also check against all your information. So this does your QA of your job. It runs business rules against visibility options of your plan, how it's, what it's relating to, if you've identified those lots in your interests and your information tab, it will be looking for those lots on your plan graphics. Your interests, if we've created easements and we haven't identified which interest polygons are associated with that interest, we'll get errors. So it does all your checks and balances for you on the run. So this is one of the great benefits of the portal, is it does your QA as you go, and then it's just a visual QA you do at the end to make sure that it's cartographically showing correctly. We'll go through that in a bit more detail as we go. And the last tab is our attributes tab. So this has got all the attributes for every point, line, angle, distance, polygon on your plan. So within our attributes, we've got point features, there's line features, so it brings in, we've got road boundaries and road constructs and lot boundaries, all our distances, bearings, measurements, datums, accuracies, all that attribute features of those lines. We've got our polygons, our angles, and control. That's generally for SSA jobs. We're still building a lot of the SSA functionality, but we're future-proofing, so we've got SSA capability and control point capability we can show in there. As well as our geometry, so our geometry is relating to our CSD data. The survey tab is going to be relating to our information data. So this is bringing forward our lots, our freehold lots 100 and 101. Those are already associated. As you can see, if we click on that, it's going to do that. This will show that's the polygon for lot 100, and it's been associated to lot 100, same with 101. This icon here is for our interest. So this has brought forward our interest we created in our interest tab. We've got our 136C and our 150 restriction of access easement there. And this middle one is our roads tab. So this is Cassidy Road, and we will need to associate that road widening with Cassidy Road. It will actually label it as a road widening because it is captured as a road widening polygon within our CSD. If it was just a road, then when we associated that Cassidy Road with that polygon, it would actually label it as Cassidy Road and give it an area. Because it's a road widening, it will purely label it as road widening with an area. We'll do that a bit later as well. So for now, we'll go straight to our geometry. You may have noticed in our plan graphics, I'll just move that across, go back to here, our points that have come in are big circles with a question mark. So CSD Editor brings all of our point types in as unidentified point features. So first thing we need to do basically is go through and associate all these points. As this is a fairly new subdivision, I'm going to say the majority of these are all going to be pegs. So we can go to our geometry tab as our points. This one selects all our IDs, so if we select them on here, it automatically selects them on our plan graphics, and then we can go to the little pencil, which is our edit tool. This is where we can change our type. So if we can now call them pegs, and they're going to be new marks, horizontal accuracy is going to be 0.25, and we'll hit save. This will then create peg features on our plan. So we've got circles for our pegs. If one of these, this one here, I'm going to change because that's an interest boundary. So I'm going to change that from a peg to be an interest point unmarked, or actually going to be a cadastral point unmarked because it's creating a break along our cadastral boundary. So I can call that cadastral point unmarked. Hit save. It will actually change that symbol to a smaller symbol for that. If it was an interest point, an unmarked interest point, we actually show it as a symbol on our design screen just so that we can go back and select it if we need to. You have a graphical representation where it is. Those do any unmarked features don't show up with it, any light, any symbols on your print mode. On black and white, they will both come up as a peg symbol, just for ease, so if we need to select that to change any of the attributes or look at that point, then we know what to select on our graphics. Instead of just trying to guess where the end of that line is, that one's fairly obvious, but if there's a bend, a small bend or something, and we wanted to select that to change an angle or connect into it, then we would have to know where to select within our graphics. Go back to there. So we've changed all our points. We can, I'll just move across a bit. Our plans now with portal plans, we've also got symbology for our points. So if this one was going to be a nail and plate, we can actually put installation comments, a nail plate in low brick wall. And we hit save. The point symbol will actually change to be symbolic for that, and we'll see it's all kind of overlapping at the moment, but it's also put your installation text on your plan. So it's labeled that point. At the moment, we don't have a legend on our plans as yet. We're still determining where the best place for a legend for portal plans is going to be, and how it's going to be displayed. So until we get our legend, we will be labeling all of our point features for the general public so they'll know what that is. So I'll say nail and plate. When we get our legend, obviously we won't be quoting as a nail and plate on the graphics. It'll just have the symbol and your installation comment if you need it. You don't have to obviously put your installation comment. It's just there if you need it at the time. In the attributes table, it's also showing up in there, so you can change any of the features in there if you want, and they will change on your graphic. This is basically where we had that panning. So if I unlock my panning and I select point 14, my graphics zoom to that thing in the center of the page. So it will zoom around your graphics. It's very handy if you've got a really big job and you just want to change a point and you want to know where it is, turn your padlock off and it will zoom to that selection. You can change multiple features at once. So if we select both of those, they're going to be spikes. So they've labeled and the symbology's changed, so you've got a cross in your road. You will note the green border has also shifted to the outside of our subject land now for our survey. Black background to green border shows up a bit khaki colour, but it will print as a green border. White background, it obviously shows as a green border. This is basically because for our restriction of access, we don't label our plans A to B anymore. We used to put a little A with an arrow to B if we wanted to restrict our access. We can't validate that information on the portal, so everything that we put on the portal, we generally would like to validate that information so we can check that it's correctly labelled and done. So for a restriction of access, we actually now put a red line across where we want that restriction to do, and we'll just put a subject label for that red line. So we'll do that for now, so we can label that interest. So I'm going to put an access restriction from basically there along, this is Hume Road. So I'll go to my construction tool, go to the polyline to create our polyline interest. There is instructions, so it selects a type. At the moment, there is only one type to select. There may be others in the future, so we've got capability for that. And now all we do is draw on the plan by connecting to existing points. Double-click on the plan to create finished point of construction. So we just hit create. Our cursor will change to a little crosshair on our graphics, and it will snap to the points on your plan. So it will automatically snap to any relevant points. it is important to note if we were doing a stricture across here, we have to pick up every point along that line. We can't skip this middle boundary point and just go from there to there. It will give you a validation error and say you've missed a point. So if there is a 180 degree angle along a line, it's going to go have you selected that point because it's a straight line and there's a midpoint along this boundary. So we'll check validation as you go through with your construction. At the moment, we just want to do a restriction against lot 100, so we'll start there and we'll snap to the points along our boundaries that we need it to, and then we just double click to finish. It has then created a boundary. It creates your boundary. I went in an anti-clockwise direction, so it will create it on the right hand side if you go in the clockwise direction. Because I went anti-clockwise, it's on the wrong side, so I can actually select that boundary. So it's created as a line here. So our covenant restricted covenant line has now been created in our line type. You can see it's selected on our graphics. We need that restriction against the lot, so it needs to actually be within our lot boundary. So one of our features up here is flip annotation or polyline. So our polyline feature we've got, so we can actually flip that along our line and it will move the red boundary to be inside our lot. So now that's pertinent to our lot 100, that's within our lot 100 boundary. So we've created that interest polyline. I'm actually going to go back to our survey tab now, and this is going to where we associate our interests with our relevant polygons or polylines. So in our survey tab, we've got our lots, our roads, and our interests here. I click on my interests. We'll start with our drainage easement. So our drainage easement, we can select that easement. So that's basically our 136C easement, burning lots 100 and 101. So if I've selected that, I can now associate that with our easement polygons in our graphics here. So to associate your interests, there's this association feature tool here. If we just click on that, it will then basically say start your association. You can go into your plan graphics, click on a polygon or highlight the relevant polygon, hit control to do multiple polygons. So we're getting our two interest polygons for our lots 100 and 101. And then we just hit tick. It will then automatically label our polygons with our interest label. So our A has turned up in the center of each polygon. We can reposition that. Zoom in, so I just get one selection. And we can reposition that label anytime. So to move features, all you have to do is select a single feature. Move your cursor over to the selection point, so you get a little blue dot. When you select it, you put your cursor over that blue dot, change it to a hand tool, which allows you to click on it and drag that annotation wherever you like. So we've now associated both those easements. If I click on that easement now, it highlights the lots that are associated with it. We'll do a similar thing with our covenant now. So that isn't associated to anything. In our association feature. This will now only allow you to select your polyline. You can't select a polygon. If you try and do that, it will give you a warning saying polygon features cannot be linked. This can only be to a polyline. So we'll unselect that, pick up our polyline. So it's highlighted that polyline. Tick that. Graphics somewhere, we should have, because it's got a bend, I don't know why it does that, but it's labelled it to be there. So that's got that association now to our covenant. We will do a likewise thing for our road. So our road widening that we have here, this polygon, I'll go to my geometry just to show you. So our polygon feature, These are all, we've got our interests, polygons, which are here, our surround, which is highlighting all of that, and our road widening is that polygon feature. That was purely just a road. Then when we associate our road, we'll actually get Cassidy Road as labeled there, but as we got it widening, it will actually label it differently. So I'll go back to my road, select our Cassidy Road, feature association button, select polygon, tick, and it's created our road widening here with our area. We can move that text out for now, and then we'll tidy up our graphics. Okay, so demo, it's not turning on for some reason. Have we got any questions? Have I lost anyone completely so far?
Following, okay.
Cool, okay. What I'll do is I will, I haven't shown you these tools yet, so I'll quickly go over those and then we can tidy up, because this is what we use to manipulate all our existing data that's on here. So we've been through our create construction tool and our annotation tool. This is a very handy little tool, our flip annotation tool. You'll notice when on our graphics, some of the dimensions and stuff are on the wrong side of the line. So this one comes through 17.5. Depends on the direction that the CSD file was captured in, depends on which side of the line it puts the annotation in the portal. We found originally, before we had this tool, you had to go through, especially a bigger job, you'd have to move multiple bits of text. With this new one, we can just select whichever annotation we want to move to a different side of the line. And then when we hit our flip tool, it simply moves it on the other side of the line at the specified distance away from the line that it was. Nice and handy for doing that. These two, our eye and our hide, no eye thing, is hiding our selected features. So at the moment, if I click on an angle in here, if I don't want that angle displaying, so I can hide, instead of deleting, I can hide that feature, and that basically disappears off your graphics. Move that one out. These 180s we don't need to show. Control, select multiples, and we can hide those. So we've got lots of other information that is hidden. This icon here is to manage our hidden things. So if we do hide an angle and we want to show it again, we can actually turn on this and we can show hidden annotations. There are different features here. I'll explain these more when I do enlargements and geometry. But if I just apply that for now, show hidden annotations, anything that's hidden will actually show up magenta on our plan. So we've got our 180s angle we hit there, our external angle to that boundary was automatically hidden from our CSD when we imported it. We can leave that on. They obviously won't print at the final stage. We can print a copy with them if we want. For some reason, if you want to show all angles for some purpose for a client or something, you can turn that on and show your hidden features on your plan that you do print. Most of the time, you wouldn't have it on, so that's that. But if we wanted to show an external angle and hide the internals, you can just turn that feature on, apply it. We can choose that 180 and choose to show it, and we can hide one of these ones. So there is options to show and hide different features that are around. With angles, there is a visibility angle tool, so you will always have to show minimum of two angles unless one of the angles is 180 degrees. So if that was 179.59, then you'd have to show two of these angles to show the intersect of these three lines. That's 180, you only have to show one angle on your plan graphics, as you would do today. I'll actually show that one. So I'll quickly just go and hide a whole lot of these that we don't need. Just so it's clear. So I've gone through and hidden heaps of our angles. This one here, because it's a four-line intersect, it's going to show minimum two angles on our plan. And I'll fix this corner up here. So I'll just quickly go through and hide what we don't need on our plan. So I've hidden both angles there, which is not what I wanted. So if I show them, apply, I can drag in and make that visible. Fair enough. Okay, so now we've decluttered a bit of our plan. We've got angles in there, two angles there. We can reposition any of our lines. We can just move. So road widening obviously isn't going to fit within a polygon. We can arrow it in or so we can create arrows or call out lines just in our construction tool set. So we can go to our line types. So our lines will allow us to create basically anything that we need on our plan. We can create lot boundaries, unsurveyed lot boundaries, road boundaries, interest constructs, local government boundaries, state forest boundaries. The list is there. We can also create fences and structures, call out lines, arrows and mineral reservations, abuttals. So all of these will have different attributes and different features to the lines. Your abuttals will just draw a straight line on your plan. It won't label it, won't dimension it, won't have an end point or a peg symbol that it requires at the end of it. Call out lines are similarly just a straight line. We'll do an arrow for this purpose. We can, it's got instructions, so we choose our arrow, hit create. Our mouse turns to a cursor. When we're in our construct tools, it will automatically snap to our lines and our points within our CSD data, our imported data. When the background field is working, you will have your lodge layer there. It won't snap to your lodge layer. It's purely there just for visual, but any of your imported data will snap to. So our road widening, we can start our feature there. It'll try and snap to your lines. If you want to stop it snapping, you can just hit your control key and it will actually turn that snap off so you can get right close to where it is. But it will snap within a tolerance to that line. So we'll just arrow that road widening in for this. And that's created our arrow feature. So if Slip was down when we logged in, it obviously doesn't display your background layer. I'll show you the white background. Yep, cool. So this Slip layer that's on here, our background layer, is basically our lodge layer from our SCDB, which is correct as of 6 o'clock last night. So it is your latest tenure information that we've got available for you. This is basically what we use. So it identified our two lots. You can easily see now a boundary realignment of what we're doing. That was our existing original boundary. We're just creating that and a bit of widening. We use this to construct our buttles now. So we can snap to our existing things, and we basically just plot or digitize off this one where those boundaries are for our buttles. We can get our latest buttle information straight from our Slip layer, and that's it for that. Eventually, we are hoping to have it so it will automatically extract your buttle lines and information straight onto your plan graphics, but that's still being developed at the moment. So until we have that, we're giving you the very latest information so you can just digitize straight from that information onto your plan. So to generate our battles, we go back to our construction tool, pick our line type. We'll change that to be a battle line. Create. This, as you can see, snaps to our CSD, so we can just start at that point. Move up, it won't snap to any of these lines, but we can trace it onto there. If we wanted to get really accurate, you can actually zoom right in. If you select the endpoint of that line, you can shift your line and it will move your line, your battle line. So you can zoom right in to get it right on the line if you wished. It isn't a battle, so we're not going to validate the accuracy of that line. Obviously, you'd want to get it fairly close, but it doesn't have to be exact standards to as you would do for your plan itself. So I'll just quickly create the rest of the battle lines on here. So when you're in creation tool, you've noticed your cursor keeps changing to the crosshair, and it will give you a big red crosshair once it's snapped to a line feature. So now we've basically drawn in our battle lines. We can cancel out of that. So we've drawn in all our battle lines. We've got a road widening. We just put in our labels for our battles. So we can go to our annotation tool, select on our create new annotation, and we will go to a battle lot. So this is going to ask us to put in our lot number and our plan number. So we can put in lot 62 on diagram. You get little crosshairs again. Wherever you click on your plan, it will actually place that annotation. So there's a 62 on that diagram. We can now do lot 21 on plan 1198. We'll do that. It saves this information, so if there's multiple lots on the same plan, then we just go change the lot number 22. Now we're going to put in our roads, so I'll do a battle road or highway. So your road name, we can do Hume Road. Because it's a road, it's always going to have to be upright, so you don't have to put upright text in here if you don't to, it will automatically default it to being upright font. So Hume Road's there. It is important to note, Hume Road at the moment comes in as just a one entity, and unfortunately there is no spaces. The portal cannot recognise spaces, so Hume Road will only have a single space for the road name. It can't have Hume and Road over there. Later on we are looking at actually creating them as two separate features, so you can separate it along a long road boundary distance if you want to. As we've got that selected, we can quickly just select the lot boundary for the road, click on our align tool, and that will rotate Hume Road. Sorry, did we have a question then? Nope. I'll quickly label Cassidy Road. So that's got our battle information all there for us. As you can see, the plan looks very busy, so we can just hide our background cadastre, and that comes back to more of a normal graphics sort of plan that we have. So that's the basics of our plan. If we want to, I'll create a couple of enlargements, and I'll show you some offset points and features. Quickly just do it, generate a PDF to show you how it's looking. Half an hour. So there's our front sheet again, and there's our plan graphics. So your interest comes up as red, your restriction of access with a subject label of B, our drainage easements A, and our new interest table is there, so it's got our A and B. If we are creating a new interest over a whole of a lot, obviously we would label it, and it will just come up in our interest table. If there's a notification, say we would just have your notification, this plan, lots 100 and 101, to whatever with our comments, and you would have no label, and it wouldn't be shown on your plan as it is today. I will now create an enlargement here for you. We'll actually create an offset point around here. So I'm just going to switch backgrounds again. Okay, so if we can't get to this corner, we want to create an offset mark along a corner. We might actually go out that way. What I can do is I can create on here an exaggerated corner offset mark. So we can go to our construction tool and we'll create, we'll do a boundary offset mark. We'll do a corner one somewhere else. So our boundary offset mark is going, we can create one in the boundary here, or we can actually go out that way. So if there's a fence out of position and we want to show a mark right at the base of the fence or something, we could actually, the instructions are here, so we select our point and the line that our offset mark's going to. We can enter the distance of our offset thing, so if it's going to be 0.25, and then we can also do an exaggerated not to scale distance. So we will actually do it. 5 meters. So it'll put it basically out there. On boundary would actually be along this boundary, so put the mark there. Adjacent to boundary would push it past our boundary. So we'll actually go adjacent to boundary. We can select our mark type. We might actually put a drill hole. So we can create that. The portal will exaggerate that, so it's actually going to label it as 0.25, but actually plot it at We can also draw in the fence if we were so inclined. So we can find our fence, create, plot in the fence, and it will show the fence on your graphics. You can adjust that position of that fence just by clicking on the endpoint and dragging that out, and move your fence. So that's creating an offset point. I will go down and create a corner offset here, and then we can show you what happens with this. So if we are here, the other thing, because we created our offset point, we'll probably change this mark to not be a peg. So if we select it on our graphics, on our attribute viewer, it also comes up as selected there. We can just go through and edit that. And we'll put that at the cadastral point unmarked, because we've got a mark for our drill hole there. Save that. We've got that. I'll change this one. That's a peg. I'm going to actually change that point now that I'm in here to be another cadastral point unmarked. Save. Okay, so this one here, we will select. We've done our boundary offset. We're now going to do an offset corner mark. So this one, slightly different instructions. Instead of selecting the point, we want to select the two lines that our offset's going to be. So we'll chuck one there. And we'll select that. So it's got our two lines. We're going to select our distance. So if we want to have our point that's actually 0.5 along and a metre out, so it's going to be out here somewhere, we would do our line 1, which is our first line we selected. So we'll go 0.5. And then our offset distance is going to be a metre. So then we're going to put 1. A lot 2 boundary, we're going to come up a metre and go up 0.5. 1. Right, click on there. 0.5. So instead of... Oh, wait a second. Let's go 0.25. 0.25. 1's a bit too much, isn't it? Yeah, 0.25. Instead of creating it there, and we can't exaggerate each of these, we can actually exaggerate by a scale factor on here. So if we want our scale factor to be 4 times, so it'll basically put it 2 meters out and half a meter there. And our mark type, we're just going to have that on plate. That'll do. Hit create. It will create our point there. So it's got the symbology for our nail and plate. And it's also shown all of our details there. You will note that it's actually fully dimensioned our offsets, which it will require to do. Because this is a nice, nearly 90-degree corner, it's easy. If it was a 60-degree corner or something, then obviously all of these distances would be slightly different, 0.25. So we do need to show them all. I'll do an enlargement for the purposes just to show you how this would work, so it gets fairly cluttered on our plan. But that's got our corner offset mark shown on our graphics as well. Before I create my enlargement, I'll just quickly show you one other feature that I need to do a fix on. When I validate, it'll keep running all the rules. So I will quickly do a validation. I'll get some rules because I haven't nominated the line style, if it's surveyed or not. So you can see now I've run my validation rules up there. I've got a lot less warnings. I've basically only got 2 here. One is for my lines. It's telling me one of the mandatory fields in my line attributes isn't shown, which is the measurement source. I can do that, so I will basically just click on select the relevant lines from my CSD. So I can select that to them by just doing hitting down the shift key, and then it will select everything from beginning to end. Go to my feature tool and change my measurement source to be surveyed. With your errors that come up on your validation, if you hover your mouse over them, it does give you more detail of what that error is. So there's an angles check too, so it's saying there's two critical errors here. Polygon 3 is missing one or more internal angles, and polygon 4 is missing one or two more angles. That's one of these, I would say. Tells you actually which point, so they are from two line pairs 19 to 18. So we can check that in a minute. I might actually even just do an enlargement for that. Okay, I'm going to change that. And interest point on that. You'll note I've changed those interests. Your angles now have changed to be 1/8 upright instead of your 2/5. It is important to note that although your font type for your lines are attributed to your line type, so interests are a 1/8 upright, where lot boundaries are a 2/5 sloping or italic. With your lot boundaries where an interest intersects your lot boundary. Traditionally, a lot of surveys would show your total line distance there and just have a 1/8 2 meter distance there for our interest boundary. Because we are intersecting our lot boundary, it has to intersect your lot boundary there to have like a midpoint on your lot boundary. That font type has to be a 2/5 italic lot type because it's attributed to that line type for that lot boundary, not an interest boundary. So where we have our interest intersecting a lot, we also need to actually create a total lot distance for this line because we've got it's a 36.95 meter long line, not a 34. So we can select your lines. So we can select both our lines, move that across, go to our construction tool, and construct a total lot boundary. This will create a boundary, 36.95, and calculate that. This is also attributed, so if we actually change one of these boundaries here, so if we go in and select our line type, 34.95, so if I select that line and I edit that and I call it 37.95, just was, oh no, I won't be so timid. If I go 35, save that, it will auto change our total of boundaries to correlate. So that is always attributed to those two lines and you won't have a total of distance that changed if you ever do need to change one of these. And we'll change it back to 34.95. And you'll see our total lot distance changes as well. So we do need to create those for wherever we have got a midpoint along the cadastral boundary. They're fairly simple to create. local plans as well, we're not creating a green border distance, so we're not doing a total lot distance for our green borders. Because we've got this total lot feature here, we can't actually always determine what is a green border distance and what's an internal distance. And the green border distance, you need to have a bracket shown on there. So we are not showing green border distances on portal plans. We have the green border. Traditionally, it's something we've had. It's not a survey requirement. It's just always been a nice to have. But because we've got green border, we're not having a total lot distance on the portal plan. So now we've created a total lot. We don't need to dissect a line, but there is functions to dissect a line if you need to for this. It will only do a single dissection at a time. I think if anyone's used a CSD editor, if you need to dissect a line, you can put multiple dissections in and just create the remainder. This will only do a single dissection and automatically calculate the remainder for you when you do your dissection. So that's covering that. The only other thing to show you would be if we go. Boundaries. So if we've selected this boundary here, and this was a ridge boundary, so if we didn't label that point at the end, and we want it actually as a measurement source as original or per ridge, we'll actually go per ridge for this one. So we're going to go per ridge because we haven't found that mark. We're going to just call that a ridge. If we save that as our line type, you'll notice on our graphics now, it's also updated our dimension to be a per ridge dimension. So it builds all your feature associations with your line type and our measurement source. So if it was cal, it will label it as, I think it labeled it as cal. But yeah, if you've got a ridge, per ridge, it will reflect all of those on our graphics, depending on the attribute of that line. So I'm aware we're nearly over time. So the last quick thing I'll show you is enlargements. I'll do enlargement of this area just for demonstration. So to do an enlargement, we have a create enlargement tool here. We create an enlargement label. You can label it whatever you like. You've got a choice. So you can show a full page enlargement or you can show four per page. That'll basically just quarter up a page and it'll put enlargement in each quadrant of that page. We do need to select a scale, as I was explaining earlier, because we keep the association of the feature types and the attributes. We can't distort one because it will actually distort on both the main plane and the enlargement page. So we can pick a scale. You select your scale and you hit your print area, it will actually draw a little rectangle on your plan that you can then move. So that's at scale 1 to 750 and 1 to 70. If you wanted to change the scale to go 1 to 200, you'd obviously get a larger area to select on your plan. So for today's purpose, I might just do a full page, 1 to 200. And then we can reposition that window wherever we like on our plan to get that enlargement area. You'll notice that when I've done it, it's actually highlighted all areas that are intersecting this polygon area for our enlargement. So it's automatically selected the polygons, the lot numbers, the distances, and anything within this. If we wanted to get an abutal for some reason, that's not part of our CSD, so that's not attributed data, so we'd actually have to manually go in, hold the control key, and select that to add that to our selection for our enlargement if we wanted to bring that information into our enlargement for some reason. A lot of time, if your plan's over there, it won't bring in any abutal we hit create now, that does a copy of our main plan data. So it's copied that data onto our enlargement sheet. You can see up here now, it's enlargement A. I can zoom out. And that's basically copied our enlargement at our scale. I'll actually just hide features outside our clipping area. So this has now re-attributed all our font at that size. So you can see our font is a lot smaller because we're displaying it as 2:1:2:100 on my scale that I've selected. We can show the hidden features. So we can turn on all our hidden features which have been copied over, and we can display things differently on our enlargement page to what's on our main plan graphic. Hide that, show that one. Got our thing there. All we've got to do is drag in the information we want onto our enlargement page. So we bring that in, bring that up. Catch up, bring that in. Obviously, your enlargement probably wouldn't be this big. Demonstration purposes. Once we've got all the annotations we want within our enlargement area, we can actually create a clipping area outside there, so we can cut off a whole lot of superfluous information that we don't want on our plan. If we wish to, we go back to our enlargement tool, and there is a clipping area button here, so we can create a fence around what we want to show. Off, save. Okay. Beautiful. So that now has created an enlargement on here. We can hide everything outside our clipping area, and that will just show basically what's on there. So now we have a main plan. You'll notice on our main plan it's actually labelled our enlargement A, so it puts that text in the middle of our enlargement window. And we can actually hide information on here that's cluttering it up, because it's now displayed on our enlargement. So we've hidden that all on our main plan graphic, but it is still visible. So there is visibility rules that are saying you can hide information as long as it's shown either on your main plan or on your enlargement or on both. So you can show it on both, but it must be visible either on your main plan or your enlargement, otherwise it'll fail a validation rule. So I couldn't hide both angles. So I've hidden one angle there, and that one, if I hit both those angles, it would actually let me, because I've got one angle on the other one, but I couldn't hide all this information here because I've hidden it on the main plan. So I'll quickly give you a demonstration. I'll validate this. Hopefully we'll only get a warning. Angles, but we don't have any visibility checks. If I go now and hide a couple of these, So if I go, I don't want to show those two there, I'm just going to hide them. And I validate again. I will actually get an error because I've hidden something on the main plan and the enlargement, and it's not showing up anywhere on my plan. So it's not going to let you create features and just hide everything. If you do some general annotation and you don't wish it, general annotation you can delete because it's not attributed or associated with any other features. So I could delete Hume Road because it's not associated with a polygon or a line. It's just a bit of text I've put on there. But I couldn't hide that on the main plan and the enlargement because it has to be visible somewhere if I've created it. So I have this visibility check, which will tell me that I've hidden one of the things on that enlargement, and it's an offset line distance of 0.5 has been hidden both on the main plan and the enlargement, and the other one is the distance of 0.25. So they must be shown if they are created, at least on something. So it has these checks to make sure that things aren't hidden mistakenly on graphics. But that's your easement. And the beauty with this is if we do make a change, so if I'm on the main plan and for some reason I need to change this distance, line 17.49, because that was adopting the ridge. So I've changed that 17.49 on my enlargement. It has also changed to 17.49. So you're never going to get the disparity between your enlargement and your main plan. And that's basically it. You can now also print straight from our hamburger menu. So when I hit print, this generates the whole plan. So it takes a little while to print. That's the beauty of the print preview within your portal. If you just want to see your graphics, what they look like, it's a quick print. This is labeled enlargement, and you'll see we now have an enlargement sheet with all our information on there, our 17.49, and all of our relevant information for that enlargement. Our road widening moved to there. I didn't reposition that. But that's basically it. So we can shift that. We wanted to change the arrow. Yeah, that doesn't really matter for now. I'm aware that we've been going for 2 hours today, but I've been talking and trying to demonstrate everything that there is. The beauty of your plan portal at the end of the day is we're hoping once we get used to it, we can generate a plan nearly as quick as you can in your CAD program. And the beauty is it does your checks and balances for you when you're in. I've got one error here because it's looking for three angles. I will actually need to turn on one of these. So if I make that visible, just for the purpose and validate that, you will find that I may have a warning. You can lodge a plan with warnings. It won't let you lodge a plan if there is an error on your portal, so you won't be able to sign it and lodge it with an error. I'm still missing an angle. Which one is that? 19, 19. Look at that. But yeah, the beauty with this is you can draft it in here and do all your checks and balances. Once you've got all your validation errors checked, it's basically just making sure that you've got your plan to cartographic standards, that there isn't text and stuff going through line work. So your plan will present properly for a thing. So normally we can't validate against that happening. That's what we rely on, surveyors and your draftees to get the cartographic standards correct on your plan. It's not wrong being there, it's just probably not cartographically accurate as we would show it. We wouldn't normally show that, but if a portal plan is lodged like that, we'll certainly will accept it because it's the data that is correct at the time. The big beauty with this is once you've done it, we've run all our validation rules. Once you've signed it and lodged it, this basically does an auto examination at Landgate. So your portal plan, when you lodge it at Landgate, will generally go to planning that day that it's lodged, or the next day, depending on how late in the day it is. We will do a quick cursory check of your plan to check that there isn't any gross errors, but we don't have to do a full audit on your plan because it has passed all of the validation rules. Even if it fails some rules or some fall out for manual examination, all we have to do is check that one issue that hasn't passed that validation rule, so we don't need to go and check the whole plan from row to go. We look at the one error that's come up, verify that error, we can pass, or we can refer it back to the surveyor for clarification. Most of the time we'll just pass, and then it just progresses straight back through the system. So it highly speeds up the audit process on Landgate end, and hence for your clients, you'll get your plan basically to planning the day it's lodged or the next day that it is lodged, which is a big bonus of portals. Hopefully, as things progress and things get better and better, the times will actually increase. The more business rules we can build in, the less likely we actually even need to have a look. So there is potential at the end of the day for a plan to go basically for past validation rules. There is potential for it to come into Landgate and go straight to WAPC basically within 10 minutes or so, but we're not quite there yet. But there certainly is potential for a very speedy turnaround of your plan through the portal. So yeah, there's definite savings on your QA side of stuff with drafting, with all of our rules that we do run when we validate. I'll quickly end the drafting side for there. So once we've drafted it and we're happy with it, we can go back to our actions menu there, and this is where we progress it through our dashboard. So we've drafted it all there, we've run all our rules. We don't have any errors. This one does. I'll have to go through and check what that is. I think it's one of these that I've messed up. I'll have to actually go do a bit more investigation. We can then progress it to ready for QA, ready for certification. So if I click on this, it's going to rerun all the rules, make sure that it is ready to be signed. This won't actually let me pass it on because I've forgotten to put in the surveyor who's going to be signing it, which will be our test person. If there is any deferred marking approval or anything else, that's where you would put it in here. Let's save that. This still won't let me pass it because I do have that error, so it will say you can't progress it because there's an error on the plan, but it would say, okay, once you've finished your drafting and you're happy with it, you can assign it to the signing surveyor, and it would actually go in the dashboard of that surveyor under ready for certification, so they can review the information tab and the design screen, print the PDF, and then sign that and lodge that PDF as part of their process. I'll go back to my dashboard just to show you what happened. So if we had fixed that angle area, I could have moved this plan on to ready for certification. So if I was logging in as the signing surveyor, it would be in my ready for certification tab just with the jobs that are ready to be signed. I could then open up the plan, review the plan information tab, all that information that's in there. You can review all the tabs. If there's any changes necessary, you can. So if you want to put in a different customer reference number, look at the interest tab, have a look at it in the design screen. There's one on this one, yep. So you can have a look at the design screen, go, yep, I'm happy with that. That's all correct. You would then print your PDF. You would note, because we're in our certification, we can't have a watermark. this stage, you can then download. So when you move your mouse to the top of your PDF screen, you get options to download that PDF. You would download it to your internal system. Save that plan to your PDF, I mean to your hard drive. This plan, you now then will need to open, you do need to open this with Adobe Reader. This computer doesn't have DC. It needs to actually be signed with Adobe Reader DC, which is a free Adobe Reader software that will allow digital signatures and the right level of encryption. Once you open it in Reader, it has the signature field. So you can enable editing, which will allow you to sign it. You click on that to sign, and this won't do it because it's not a Reader subject, so it does need to be that Reader DC. You'd attach your digital signature, save it back to your local drive, and that's the PDF that you then lodge in your portal. You can't make any changes to the PDF itself, otherwise it won't validate. So basically, we put a signature on there for the surveyor to sign. There's also a ghost signature that Landgate puts on to lock up the PDF, so you can't alter any of the information on the PDF itself. That way, we can guarantee that the PDF is exactly the same as what's in the portal. So that's got that, and then once you've got that PDF, you can then basically move to your ready for lodgement. And attach your, I don't know, you still want certification, won't let me. You'd have to go to your lodge tab and attach that PDF. So in your Lodge tab, we have one attached already. When we're in certification in your Lodge tab, this is where you would attach that PDF that you've just signed. So you can click there, find your PDF you've signed using Adobe Reader DC, upload that file. It will actually validate your signature and it will check that PDF hasn't been altered and that is the latest one generated out the portal. Fails either of those, it won't actually let you upload it. So once it's uploaded, then you just attach anything else that you need relevant to your survey. You'll note there's no CSD file in here because it's already attached the CSD that it's pulling out of the design tab of your portal plan. If you need any of these other things, so the mandatory fields would have to be attached. Anything else is optional for your survey. If you've received any advice from Landgate, then you can put in there whatever advice you've done, any general comments. It'll automatically calculate your fees for you. You just hit your confirmations, save that, and then you can go to your lodge and lodge your plan. And that will basically get you through the portal. So they can go through at any stage whenever you're ready for it. So you can have your plan in design for as long as you like, QA, ready for certification. Not sure of people's work practices, if you will only sign it just before you're lodged, or if you can sign it and waiting for clearances, you can sign it and move it to ready for lodgement. Then once the clearances are through, as soon as they come through, anyone in the office who's got lodging capability can then assign the plan to them and lodge the plan once clearances are through if there's no additional changes made. And that's how it basically progresses through the dashboard. Once it's lodged, your plan will be in a list there where you can lodge your additional amendments or replace the plan or do whatever you need to do as per usual today. Yes, that's smack on 12 o'clock. Have I got any questions at all? No, well, that's about it. So I'm very aware that it's been a very big whirlwind, me talking lots and lots and lots, but hopefully I've covered Apple page. I'll quickly just show you where they are. NLR plan. So when you click onto NLR plan, and these are all, so we have got quick videos. We will be putting this video on there, so there may be a link to this. This is going to be a very long video, but these only go for 5 minutes or so. So there's different sections for different features that are in there. They're very handy to have a look at. You can always email RRP or try and call Jack and I, and we can help you out. We may not always be available on the phone because we're in meetings and stuff, but we will always get back to your emails or messages that you leave and try and give you assistance. But yeah, definitely encourage you to go in and have a play, create as many of them as you like. Just in your dashboard, you can always delete them out of your dashboard, but they're very handy to go back to. And the more familiar you get, the more it kind of makes sense as you go. It takes a little while just getting used to it, but it does make sense after a while, and it ends up being quite a very handy tool. There's some very useful features in the portal for doing your plans. But always around for assistance if you need to get hold of one of us as well. And I think that's about it. Has anyone got any pressing questions they want or need?
I'm pretty much right there, Kerry. Thanks for all your effort into that, mate.
No worries. Sorry, it was a big, long talk fest. I'm very aware that it's a huge amount of information just to absorb in.